I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane. Glad to have you along. Today's conversation is about public safety, the police and public safety. The names Jamar Clark, Philando Castile are names that have arisen to a level of both anger and celebrity, not only in Minnesota, but around the country, I'd say perhaps around the world. When you say those names, people think automatically about police brutality, about systemic injustice, the oppression of black people, the danger that black men, black boys face every day in communities like Minneapolis and St. Paul and communities around the country. We want to talk about that today, and I want to talk to people who were sort of front line in organizing the resistance, the call to action, the call to protest, who are demanding justice. Please welcome the guest. Jeremiah Ellison is a visual artist. He's a candidate for 5th Ward City Council in Minneapolis. And Raeisha Williams is an organizer and also a candidate for 5th Ward City Council in Minneapolis. I'm so glad both of you are here, number one. I'm so glad that both of you have decided to run for public office to challenge and to seek to serve our community as leaders of the ward in the city council. Also today, OSP, a musician, an educator, Robert OSP French, an artist, and he's going to talk about his work in educating, but also his art and his ability to address the question of violence, of perception, of brutality, all the things that make this complicated story a compelling story. And finally, a friend, a leader, an elder in the community, James Burroughs. James Burroughs is actually on the staff of the governor of Minnesota. He's the chief inclusion officer at the governor's office in the state of Minnesota. So thank you all for being here. Let me use as context your feelings, your thoughts, Brother OSP. When I say Jamar Clark, Philando Castile, as a teacher, as an artist, what comes to mind?
First thing that comes to mind for me is Tysel Nelson, Lawrence Miles, Abuka Sanders, brothers that came before them that were gunned down by police officers in the wrong manner. Also think about the fact that education and our family networks at home have a lot of fruit to bear and responsibility upon what happens in our neighborhoods and how our neighborhoods are perceived. So therefore, the police that come into our neighborhoods that police them. If they're not police from that neighborhood, then maybe they don't understand those children or those men or those sisters. And it's guns raised before it's words spoken. And this is nothing new. It's just a new page in the book.
So the question of police violence against black people, you say it's nothing new. What is new in our response? What should our response be? Are we responding properly, both internally and educating our families, our children, our neighborhoods about how we can be safe, you know, from both each other, where we present challenges together, but also against law enforcement that sometimes is summary in its approach to dealing with us in a situation?
Well, I think many of the, I believe that Black Lives Matter has forwarded the conversation into a national picture. What I fear is that after the wave is gone and the protests have left, that the groundswell for support and the foundation for something that means something in the neighborhood seems to have left. The kids that I work with, they don't even bat an eye at Black Lives Matter. I mean, I'm working with kids with gun charges. They're trying to come to high school and get an education, but they got a fifth grade reading level. So that kid, primarily, I'm working in this situation where it's a pipeline from school right to the jail cell. They don't have much of a choice when they come out. So I think the way to get to them, to try to change it, I think we're doing some great things, but we have to go a step further. You know, so if like Black Lives Matter, when they leave, if they leave a chapter, somebody to talk to, if the community organizes in a way where we can check in. I think Mad Dads, you know, through the 90s and 2000s, I mean, they're still here now. You know, and they're good people to be able to contact with. But, you know, I'm not saying in regard to the Black Panthers, but in a way where there was some sort of headquarters where people could talk to someone. Look, I've been harassed. Okay, well, do you have a badge number? Is there some way for us to track it? Or is it just something when someone gets shot, we all gather up and we protest and we march with signs and we put it on CNN. Is that enough? I would say no. I say more organization is needed to further the conversation after Black Lives Matter leaves. Because after they leave, all that's left with the 4th Precinct comes out and they look like the National Guard with AR-15s.
Raeisha, you were one of the organizers of the 4th Precinct occupation. Talk about that.
Yeah, well, you hit on a couple of good things, but talk about it in the capacity of me being a part of it, or?
Yes, any way you want to. What's on your mind?
Woo, you hit on some points, brother. So yes, yes, and yes to everything you just said, and I'm total agreeance. Being one of the main organizers, one of the first individuals on the ground that day with Nakima Jason, former president of NAACP, current president of NAACP.
Full names.
Yeah. Nakima and Levy Pounds, who's running for mayor. And Jason So, who's currently the NAACP president chapter. We were the first ones out there, the very first group out there. And that's because we all live right there in that community. And when it happened, we had people who were at Elks the night before when the incident occurred, who called us and had our numbers and said, this happened, what's next? What are we gonna do, right? So it's cause and effect. And we hadn't experienced something like that locally, not on that level. I mean, God rest his soul, Q the Blacksmith had been murdered by the police and many were outraged, and we had, to an extent, we had a movement with that, but the stamina, the energy hadn't picked up the way it did with Justice for Jamar. And so being out there the very first day, doing the very first press release, calling for community members to come out and support and stand up for an injustice that had occurred and for us not to sweep it under the rug, but make a really, really loud noise about it, was empowering. And then to reach out to Black Lives Matter, who had been out in the forefront for many months before this had occurred, to come and be a part of that with us and do those collaborations. So here you had the new NAACP chapter, which was newly put together under new leadership, and this was our first big action. And we reached out to other organizations who had already been doing the work and had been doing it really, really well, who knew how to organize in a way that we weren't prepared to organize. And so through that acknowledgement, we reached out to other groups like Black Lives Matter and even Black Liberation. And we said, listen, the community wants to march and we don't have the capacity to do that, but we have the people who are ready to do it. Would you lead this march? Would you lead this protest? And so that's how it kicked off. Many of you around this table were there that night that we had a call to action at Urban League with the mayor and many other community leaders who were elders and who had been in the community doing the work before us. And that was when I saw the rift between elders, right? And people like to call them the old guard, but elders and the new generation. Elders who had put the work in before, who were radical in their own right in their days, but had transitioned into more of a corporate frame of organizing. And young people who were absolutely fed up with being murdered, with police brutality and their lives being undervalued, and sort of that clash. And then how do we move forward as a community? So that's sort of, in a nutshell, my experience,
that's
yeah.
That's a great story. So let me bring Jeremiah in. You were out there early on as well. Mm-hmm. Tell me how your engagement started and describe what happened from your point of view.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I come to this as a visual artist, as a community member, was born and raised in North Minneapolis. I was there on the first day. I remember seeing folks around. I wasn't invited in the same way. I don't think I got a call also about like just hours. It must have been, 6 hours after the actual shooting had happened, that a number of us were out there early in the morning talking to folks. And just I was kind of playing that a real background role just to listen, just to figure out like what's going to happen here. And so when I saw that the overnights were happening, like the actual people sleeping in the doorway, I feel like people tend to forget that it started off in the doorway, right? Just that little five feet of space in the fourth precinct where people were sleeping. Yeah, about eight people sleeping in that doorway. And I thought that if anything unique was going to happen, if we were going to be the type of city that responded in a unique way, that didn't bring the police out to drag people away, to, you know, to do mass arrests and all that other stuff, I felt like it could have happened in those first 3 days. But instead of seeing a group of dedicated organizers who could have thousands of people outside their door, the police sort of read it as, oh, there's apathy here. There's not a big, there's not a groundswell here. And so instead of being like, hey, how can we talk to the organizers in this doorway who are spending nights here and we know they're dedicated and we know they're organized, they kind of were like, all right, drag them out. And on that third day, later that night, you saw thousands of people outside the precinct, and it stayed like that for another 15 days. And so, you know, I tried my best just to be, my interest was always to keep just community members safe, right? Because I have a tremendous amount of respect for all the organizers of the 4th Precinct, but that's not my vantage point, right? I paint murals, you know, do illustrations for a living, born and raised just a few blocks away from where the shooting happened. And I felt like it was difficult. It kind of felt like constantly, you know, we sent folks to the mayor's house to see, is there any way to resolve this in like a diplomatic way? You know, went and crashed the mayor's office the next day. Just like, how can we, you know, have a different response as a city? I remember it being incredibly frustrating. You know, and that third day, that always sticks with me. There were four people in that doorway, right? Started off as a couple hundred folks outside on the first day, eight people sleeping in the doorway. On the third day, there were four people. And I'm like, man, can't have a sensible conversation with four organizers? Can't have a measured conversation with four organizers? You know, and I think that the city really paid, and the North Side specifically paid a huge price for those decisions. On top of Jamar's life, paid a huge price for the inability for there to be any kind of diplomacy in that moment.
The takeaway right now, then, in hindsight, and around the question of organizing, how effective was the organizing? How important is the organizing? How will you use organizing in the future? Is organizing and protest enough? Is it a waste of time? Some people will say, you know, they were inconvenienced by having to drive around the protest site, both in St. Paul, or particularly North Minneapolis, I think it was. So what's your looking back? You know, what did you learn? What was the value of the experience? And what are you taking to the future?
So what I learned is that when a community is, when they're attacked and then they come together and they push back, there's power in numbers, right? And so what a lot of people don't know and a lot of people weren't privileged to is that there was constant intel meetings happening. And when people didn't think that there was security out there, there was security out there.
When you say intel meetings, what do you mean?
Different organizations, we were all meeting, we all had conference calls, and we were all on offline mobile devices, and we were always communicating.
Working
and so
together.
While always Black Lives Matter and NAACP were constantly in communication, even if we didn't agree on necessarily certain steps, we were always in communication.
And did you not agree upon?
Well, you know, everybody has an opinion on how things should go. Mm-hmm. And when you're in the heat of the moment, and you think you know what's best, all of us, you try to do what's best based off of your thoughts and your efforts. And what I will recognize is that there were a lot of elders that came into those circles and said, we have to move forward. And it wasn't a lot of inner bickering. It was just different conversations and takes of steps of actions and how we should move forward the occupation. So what I'll say is, stepping back, what I learned is that we did a good job. We kept people safe. We kept people safe because every day my life was being threatened. Every day many of the organizers' lives were being threatened. And even though we had white supremacists who came down to shoot at us, it would have been a lot worse if it wasn't for the intel we had. So we had
the
people.
The threat you're talking about is not in a metaphorical sense.
No, no, no.
You're talking about actually threatening.
I'm talking about stuff left on my porch.
Tell me about it.
Well, stuff left on my porch. I can't go into, you know, full detail because investigations are still underway. But constant email messages sent to me, constant messages on Facebook sent to me, phone calls. My phone is it's public record. So being harassed in that capacity, I'm the contact on all the NAACP media advisories. And so being directly contacted because of the advisories that were and how I was involved and the level that I was involved. But I do want to say that, again, going back to the security, and shout out to the brothers, the Native American brothers, we reached out to a number of groups in the community who do security work, and the Native American brothers who came, what are they, the ARM? I can't remember the name of the group, and I'm really missed for not remembering. But they came out, and they were undercover every single day, and people didn't realize that. We had brothers who were coming from the militia and the military who were there armed, legally ready every day. The reason why the white supremacists weren't able to let off the way they did, the rounds of shots that they did and fire that they did right there in the occupation, was because they had been moved out from the occupation. So we had created a security. Even the brothers who live right there on Plymouth Avenue had been trained in security. And I always give those brothers kudos, because the night before, when my brother was on security duty, the same men who shot at the protesters, he had walked them off and had physically picked them up and removed them from the occupation. So what I'm saying is while it may have looked chaotic, there were a lot of different security measures put in place that people weren't privy to, right? Most people didn't know.
Jeremiah, what do you think? Looking back, organizing, necessary, important, effective, yes or no, and as a tool for the future, how do you see it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think organizing is incredibly important. I think that...
Organizing and protest.
Organizing and protest, I think, are incredibly important. They allow people to know that there is support for whatever it is that they're feeling, right? They say, okay, and that was one of the, I think, the really big assets coming out of the 4th Precinct, was that you had folks who had never really been politically involved, didn't really know whether any of their concerns of their daily life were political concerns, and they found out that in fact, okay, some of the concerns in my life are indeed political, and here's a way for me to get involved. One of the lessons from the 4th Precinct is that method of protesting, while I think effective in highlighting and building narrative, highlighting the story, and letting us know who this person was and fighting for justice for them, mm-hmm. I think that it's a very depleting way of organizing. We know people who it was cold for an extended mm-hmm. amount of time. You know, there are really talented, smart people who've walked away with like really bad respiratory problems because of the cold, and they're sleeping out there, right? Mm-hmm. Walking away with people who walk away with, quite frankly, certain degrees of trauma because they're inhaling CS gas, they were maced on multiple occasions. And so I think that I learned that we've got to, I think I always imagine myself like kind of making it to old age, right? And I'm like, if I'm still doing this work at the age of 88, right, what's going to get me there? Mm-hmm. And it can't be just me making it to 88. We need thousands, millions of people making it to that age, right? And not just making it to that age, but making it with this sense of social justice, not getting disillusioned, not getting burnt out, not getting tired. And so one of the things that I took away was, all right, how can we use, how can we kind of compound our strategies mm-hmm. so that people don't have to be out in the cold, you know, inhaling, mace and gas for weeks, right? Mm-hmm. How can we utilize art not as an aesthetic sort of latching on, right, of the protest, but as a form of protest and as a way to carry the story forward? How can we use policy to so that we don't kind of go into this ebb and flow of, you know, violence and response? So those are some of the things that I think I took away and hope to build off of and hope to learn from and hope to be in collaboration with all the folks who were there and people who weren't there, people who are newly politicized, so we can kind of develop that.
Let's continue this conversation in a minute. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, you just heard Jeremiah Ellison, an artist, a visual artist, and a candidate for Minneapolis City Council, Ward 5, and Raeisha Williams, a community organizer, one of the NAACP executives involved in organizing the 4th Precinct occupation and campaign, the protest, calling for justice for Jamar Clark and later Philando Castile, and Raeisha also a candidate for 5th Ward City Council seat. We're going to hear in a minute again from Brother OSP, the artist, and I'll introduce James Burroughs from the governor's staff. Stay tuned. This is Conversations with Al McFarland. I'm Al McFarland. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarland. Topic today is police and public safety. And one of the things that you did with me a few days ago at the radio station, we interviewed Robert OSP French, is did a piece that was reflective of the neighborhood, Remember When.
Yes.
Can you do some of that to continue setting the mood for this conversation?
Yeah, sure. Well, my pops on the south side, raised by my moms on the north side. Project separated downtown like apartheid. Pardon my roots, but I've seen hard times and I never take a moment to back down. How can I? Come from nothing into something. In the hood, you get a little something, then you start fronting. Besides the police, we never ran from nothing. As soon as the weather break, everybody starts stunting. Pinshaw was hot, Broadway was the ish. Back in the day, Northside was home to the Crips. Shotguns in 60s, real G's and folks. Mikey Turner escort wagon on them triple gold spokes. DOC banging out the trunk, rumbled the block. Around the same time, Tysel Nelson was shot. Dirty cops was common as roaches. Brown rounds and biker shorts that made us lose focus. The Northside, the 80s was crazy for real. Mickey D's on Plymouth and Penn, get an 8-ball in your Happy Meal. But we was happy, still nappy as hell. Running the streets and fleets, top of the world. We used to meet Fallview, North Commons, and Farwell Park. Down at Willett basketball courts, fighting pits in the dark. North Side is my heart, from Glenwood to Dahlin, Hollywood styling at the Riverview Wildin'. Memories have me smiling. Pioneers of the craft, IRM crew, first cats to put raps on wax. Travatron's hip hop shop, Freddie Fresh scratched the wax. Truth Maze, Kelsey, living proof of the facts. Raw Villa, household, stage one, bro son, a kill. Mash out a Musa, ill brothers with skill for real. Hot scheme, sunburn, and pencil. Contact, Sandman, Mac-a-Lot, dead and gone. Northside hip-hop personified. Twin Cities hip-hop without us is an awkward lie. Older now, but my memory's fine for the record. A bunch of sleepless nights on top of classic records. It was me, Ken Callis, Del Dilla, and Chuck Chisel. Everyday living hip-hop culture official. Loose cannon, no safety on the pistol. Then was the days, backpacking down memory lane. Man.
Fuck. Yes!
That's great. You know, so it sets up, I think, a picture in our minds of the community of growing up, you know, no matter what level we are. And so, you know, James Burroughs, you and I are the elders that are on this table here. And, you know, you hail from Detroit, but I've been here a long time, almost from here. But we know community. We know our people. And so when we hear this conversation, young leaders organizing, dedicating themselves to seek justice and to say they put their lives and their intelligence and their working capabilities on the line to serve our community as they seek to be elected. I think that's a wonderful thing. I think the context, though, is one that is an ongoing and unending threat of horror. These killings and others, and then the killings that we do of each other, horrible. In this context, how do we create a state that elevates, supports these young people and brings peace to our community and that allows us to exercise the levers of power for the benefit of our community and our state? What do you think?
Okay, that's an easy question.
Huh? Easy question.
Well, I think it's a couple of things. So one is I wanna thank these young people for doing the protesting. You asked earlier, is protest necessary? Absolutely. I'll tell you what protesting got with the Philando Castile shooting. Mm-hmm. So I work for the governor's office and chief inclusion officer, but I also do other duties as assigned. So when Philando Castile was shot, that night we got a call as senior leadership staff. We were at the governor's mansion. And those protests that kept going at the governor's mansion throughout, got the governor to listening, got us to listen and say, okay, what can we do differently policy-wise, legislative-wise, looking at public safety from a different lens that I don't think we would have looked at but for people being on the streets protesting on a regular basis. I think the governor and leadership learned from Jamar Clark what either did or didn't happen. I don't want to get into that. But we had meetings at the governor's mansion with Black Lives Matter leadership. I was consistently talking to Nakima Levy-Pounds, who was the president of NAACP at that time. And the difference is they had somebody who, although I'm not from here, I've been here 25 years, and I've grown enough to be an elder in the community now. It's even weird to say, but I am 59, so I guess I am on the elder side. But I've been around folks on the north side, on the south side, and doing the work. So when it came to say, what can we do differently, we may not always agree, but we need to be at the table. So that protesting put us at the table, Black Lives Matter at the table, NAACP at the table, law enforcement at the table. And what the governor said, which people forget about, he said the reason that Philando was stopped had to do with racism. He called it out. I don't think he would have called it out but for those protests that continue to happen and that voice being heard. So it's absolutely necessary. And what goes on from there is even more important. So the governor, myself, and leadership put together a law enforcement and community council that came out of the Philando Castile shooting. It's not perfect. I'm not going to say that at all, but it's 32 members of community and law enforcement at the table saying, what can we do differently from our actions, our behavior, and investing more money in this problem that we have in order to address it? So police training will come out of that. More diversity in the law enforcement workforce will come out of that. Mental health support from the officer side and also the community side as well. Dealing with the trauma that this young man talked about as well. All of those things are on the table, and the only reason, not the only reason, one of the main reasons they're on the table is those protests you talked about. So I commend our young folks and our older folks who are out there too, making sure that those voices get heard.
So Raeisha, you talked about elders coming and young people there and a divide being apparent. Explore that. And I'm raising the question from my side of that equation, saying I don't think that's really
Let me be clear.
As big as it is,
but
maybe it is.
Let me clarify. So what I was talking about was that particular night at Urban League.
Okay.
But that's not true for the community as a whole. My mother's an elder in the community, and on Thanksgiving, we had a Thanksgiving dinner, and Zion Baptist Church cooked for us, and Wayman AME Church cooked for us. And you know who was cooking in the kitchen? Elders, right? And we had lots of elders. Josie Johnson, Dr. Josie Johnson came out to the vigil that we held for the NAACP one night. There was countless elders out there, you know? And so in terms of like the occupation being divided with young and old, that's very untrue. I'm talking about leadership and people having a different view on how to move forward. I want to commend you for having that lens that it's very important to do protests. Because what for me that did was it started the conversation and it gave voice to the voiceless and it empowered those who felt like they never had power. There are endless individuals who've come out of this both occupations and now are not just activists but are running for seat, have become advocates at the national and local level. I mean, there's so many lobby days, particularly focusing on social justice, criminal justice reform, and African-American issues that are taking place on the Capitol now because of these occupations. And every time I attend those Capitol lobby days, most of the people there that I recognize are out of the occupations who never were involved in this process before. And so, so it's important that we have all the context of, yep, there were some elders who weren't happy. There were quite few young people who didn't agree with the protest. And that's okay. The difference is that this protest and those occupations started the conversation. Unfortunately, it didn't move the way we wanted it to in Minneapolis. But we're definitely reaping a lot of the benefits out of the one in St. Paul. And we see that.
You know, when you say it didn't move the way you wanted it to, tell me about that.
So a lot of the elected officials in office, city level, and the mayor, in fact, they weren't ready to hear the conversation. Like Jeremiah said, a number of us showed up for different meetings at the mayor's office and JOC and had many meetings with them. And what it was is it was controlling what the occupation looked like versus controlling how we would move forward collectively. And that was the difference that being in both leadership roles in both occupations that I saw with St. Paul's leadership and Minneapolis leadership. When we came to St. Paul, there were countless people, Melvin Carter, who would extend themselves. What do you need? How do we move the conversation forward? Let's really make some serious changes in how we're going to move the process forward. And when I say changes, we're talking about convictions and sending people to court to deal with their convictions. And that didn't happen in Minneapolis. All we constantly heard in Minneapolis was, not all cops are bad. And guess what? You're absolutely right. That's not what we're saying. What we're saying, in Jamar's instance, there were some real issues with how the police reacted when they arrived to the scene and how they dealt with him. And there were a lot of discrepancies that ended up even in the prosecution from Mike Freeman's office. And so when Mike Freeman came out and made his choice not to prosecute, after he said his piece, a lot of us went back to the document that he released, and there were discrepancies between what he had said at the press conference and what were actually documented, you know, findings in the documentation. And so we're saying the transparency wasn't even there in Minneapolis. And it was just outright lies. St. Paul did a better job of trying to be transparent. Are they perfect? Absolutely not. But I feel like they did a much better job in trying to be transparent through the process and not go back to the good old boys status quo of not all police are bad and we're going to protect our boys in blue.
How to look to you, James. I think John Choi's decision to charge in St. Paul was major. It didn't happen in Minneapolis. How did that play out for you as an individual and also from your position? You know, what ought to be happening and how can the interest and the will of the people come forward?
So I think from my individual self as a black man growing up in this country, it's good to see that at some point in time, people will be charged for what could be crimes. Now, a jury has to be impaneled, trial has to happen, and they'll ultimately decide. But for a long time, no charges were ever being brought. Yeah. And it couldn't be all the time. Right, it could be, you know, a time that, you know, sometimes you just have to go with it and make a charge. And when Mike Freeman didn't make that charge, and I know Mike for years, we used to be on the Summit Academy board together, I wrote a piece on Facebook talking about, I don't understand, because I saw all the evidence, I laid it out, I said, at the very least, there's enough to go to trial with and then determine that going forward. So in St. Paul, I want to commend Ramsey County, I want to commend John Choi, because I don't know why he did it, because I don't speak for him. But he brought somebody onto his team who's also an African-American attorney, been here many years, Don Lewis, and he had another lens that he was looking through. So he didn't identify a special prosecutor that some people wanted him to do, but he's had another lens to his team that could see things a little differently. And I don't know if that's the reason why a charge was brought or not. I wasn't in that room, but that came out of protest. That came out of people saying, hey, we need a special prosecutor. We need something different to be done. We can't do it the same way. So we have to keep that voice being heard.
I'm surprised because people assumed that because Don's corporate profile being brought to this assessment, it automatically meant charges would not be brought. Right. And so there was a great deal of surprise.
Right. Well, people forget about Don, because when I got up here, I was a law clerk for a federal judge for 2 years. Kenny Saffold and Don Lewis were in the U.S. Attorney's Office prosecuting folks on a regular basis. They were some of my mentors. So they forget about that criminal aspect of Don rather than just the corporate piece as well. So, and that's another thing. I love the fact that when young people and elders talk and we communicate, we're not reinventing the wheel. That's we're all on the same thing for justice. Right. And how we get there, it may look a little different. But when we talk and communicate, we say, you know what? I wouldn't have agreed with how you did it, but you know what? We're moving forward in the right direction. I think that's what's important going forward as we have more people down at the Capitol protesting. I mean, if you don't know, there are a lot of protest bills that are in front of the legislature now identifying ways in which protests will and will not be allowed. I'm not in a position and won't speak on those bills, but people need to be there and listen to see what they need to do one way or the other. The other thing people need to understand, too, is your voice matters to the governor, my boss. When you're down there protesting, when you write letters to the governor's office, when you make phone calls, he pays attention to that. And we pay attention to that, saying, okay, what do we need to do differently to move this needle forward as well? He likes to tell a story that in 1968, he was protesting Nixon, and he was on the watch list for Nixon because it was against the laws at the time to protest against the President of the United States. So he values those kind of things, and people need to hear about those stories and more as well. So I'm so glad that, well, let me back up. I'm not glad these things have happened. They're tragedies, they're losses of life, and I feel very sorry for that. But since they happened, the things that people have done to make sure that our community is addressing these things going forward, I'm very proud of our community. And I'm proud of those folks who were impacted by it. So I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that Clarence Castile, who's the uncle of Philando, is on our Law Enforcement and Community Council, has been there from day one, has been working with us since before the funeral. What people don't know, and it's not a, I'm not saying this to get any accolades, but working with the family, we've been doing that since after the shooting happened, making sure the repast went well, making sure the funeral went well, making sure it went to the cathedral. And we've continued to do that, and Clarence has been a part of that, and so has Valerie, and saying, okay, how do we change what's happening in Minnesota? Philando should be a representation of how we make a change together. And I've been blessed to have their full support, the governors have their full support as well, which has been a great.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. We'll continue after these messages. When I come back, I want to focus on your interest, Raeisha and Jeremiah, in serving the city, putting your hat in the ring to run for city council. I want to say I can't tell you how much I applaud you both, how proud I am that you both have decided to seek the public support for serving our city council. And so I want to have that conversation. I want you to have time to talk about what's motivated you and what you want to bring. Why do you see yourself serving our community? So we'll have that conversation in just a minute. Come back in a second. I'm Al McFarland. This is Conversations with Al McFarland. I'm Al McFarland. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarland. The topic broadly is police and public safety, but I want to take a deeper dive into the question of representation, of equity. And two of my guests here have declared their intent to run for city council in Minneapolis. I live in Fifth Ward, North Minneapolis. I've been there for as long as both of them have been alive, I think. So we all have connections here. I remember, and I know both families quite well. And so when you both announced that you were going to run for city council, I was and I remain elated. So I want to take a minute to ask you how you came to the decision, what you want to do, how you intend to serve our community. So I want you to share that with me and share it with our viewers and listeners as well. Raeisha Williams?
Sure. So I worked in government for many years in Washington, D.C. after graduating from Howard University. And then returned home because I was going to save up for a year and then move to South Africa. So I was out of this country. And when I got back home, Mike Brown happened. And that's where the movement for Black Lives started to pick up in Minneapolis, and I started to follow it. Tania Harris happened in Robbinsdale, who was my best friend's daughter. And I led that march, and that's how me and Akima became who we are together to each other, along with Black Lives Matter. So that's how I got to this place, being involved in those activities, those actions, and having my political background. I knew that it wasn't going to be enough to be in the streets, right? So, yep, protests are really important, but when we got to that door and we started knocking on the door and demanding for our voices to be heard, if no one opened that door, then it would be none and void, and they would fall on deaf ears, which has happened. And we needed somebody inside who really was going to work with us to be at the table, right? And it's not good enough to say we have a person of color representing us already, or even a Black person, let's be honest. Mm-hmm. Everybody Black is not for us and doesn't care about our issues. You know, we have a talented 10th syndrome, right? I'm not like them, I've moved on. I'm not like that, right? I could have lived anywhere when I moved back to the Twin Cities and decided to move right in North Minneapolis, which is one of the last Black frontiers in the Twin Cities, right? That's the Black community, that's the hub. We had one in South Minneapolis where I grew up, no longer exists. And so I wanted to be around my people. So when I moved to North Minneapolis and I started to notice all the disparities, but the potential, like we have the last business corridor in Minneapolis to be developed, Broadway is it. That's the last business corridor. And if we take businesses, particularly African-American businesses, and start to put them in there, what does the economy look like for that community? Well, number one, we know historically that African-Americans hire other African-Americans. So you're talking about employment rate rising. We also know that African-American businesses flourishing means the African-American business, community will flourish. And so those are the ideals that started to run around in my head. Like, how do we redevelop this community? What does that look like for us? How do we get involved beyond social justice, right? Like, how do we have tangible change? And we know economics is always where it begins. That's the beginning of it. And so I said, I started asking people, who's gonna run? Because Blanc ain't it. He's not doing it for the community, and he has no intention, and it's all about gentrification for him. So who's gonna run? I started having those conversations with people who've already been doing the work in the community before I relocated. And no one was, at the time, stepping up. And I'm a doer, right? So if I know I have the capability, the experience, and if there's people behind me who say, we support you and we want you, then let's go, you know? And so that's what made me take up the mantle of, I'm gonna run for city council. What I envision doing is rebuilding our community. And one of my things is revitalization, not gentrification, right? Everybody's welcome to move to North Minneapolis. I don't have a problem with that. But it can't be at the disparities of the people who already reside in North Minneapolis. So how do we do that? I'm talking about creating fair housing opportunities. We already know that most of the people in North Minneapolis in that zip code of Ward 5, highest unemployment, lowest income. So it's gonna be hard for them immediately in the next 2 years to purchase properties. But how do we ensure within those next few years while we're preparing them, or we're trying to find them employment to then build their credits, to then get a funding for the housing that they want, how do we ensure that they don't get priced out? We do rent caps, right? Which they do in New York, they do in LA, they do in parts of Atlanta. And so there's a lot of ways that we can hold on to the community that we know now, that we can build it to be a better community for tomorrow, and that we can have a community, right? We need a community. Other groups have communities in Minneapolis, and that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. African Americans need a place to call home. So if I would have left, in closing, and left 2 years ago and moved on to South Africa, and years later decided I want to go home, my fear was that there was going to be no home to go to, and I would have to relocate to a suburb or some other community, and I wouldn't have that African-American-based community that I so long for. So that was encompassing, yeah, all
story,
of the things.
Great story. So let me turn to you, Jeremiah Ellison. How did you come to this decision to run?
Yeah, it was it was kind of a long process. Like, I paint murals for a living. That's what I do. I'm also a writer and an illustrator. Had my art studio right above. Grew up going to Juxtaposition Art. Started there when I was 8 years old. It's funny. Like, I never really, like, my first art, materials weren't, like, you know, paint and brush. It was, like, aerosol, right? And so, I felt like, you know, that's where I got my start. Plymouth Avenue, funny enough, like, I've, you know, kind of just been learning about, like, the whole history of Plymouth Avenue, from even before 66 on. That's where I painted my first mural at age 8, right? And that building's not there anymore. We see that up and down the corridor. When it got ready to, to run, when I got ready to, like, kind of start thinking about, okay, what are we going to be doing? It did come out of a lot of frustration, not just with the response of the police at the 4th Precinct, but even before that. I actually was worked at the city for a year doing essentially an artisan residency program. It's called Creative City Making, and I was hired as a Creative City Making artist, and the job was to work in City Hall and figure out, like, how do we make the city process more accessible. And as an artist in a bureaucracy, it was sort of this impossible task, right? And you saw things like the Working Families Agenda or other sort of bits of legislation sort of get picked apart over time, and the whole apparatus as a whole just seemed really inaccessible. And so I thought, you know, I was born and raised in North Minneapolis, and I think that when it comes to accessibility, when it comes to these core values of collaboration, and at the time I actually was kind of talking about a project with this with some researchers at the U of M about doing a comic book about gentrification, and so it was sort of like, you know, so I was kind of taking in a lot of information and seeing, like, these maps and seeing that North Minneapolis is one of the last places where there is some natural affordability in the area, right? And yeah, is that going to remain? Well, the current growth trend would say that's not going to remain, right? But not all development is gentrification. And I think that conflation, we have a lot of council members that that conflate development, gentrification, sort of as the same thing. And they're definitely not. And so I looked at things like Chokwe Lumumba, who was elected mayor in Jackson, Mississippi in 2013. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, having somebody with a more like, if you have like a more like radical politic and you hold that, but you steep it in research, you know the policy, you know how to move what needs to be moved in order to get certain things done. Chokwe and what they did down in Jackson, Mississippi was a really great model for that. He ended up dying a couple months into his term, but I was really inspired by that, to see somebody who was, you know, largely sort of like an outsider in terms of how he lived his life, but then being able to say, you know, I can pass policy now that I know it well enough that that falls within my values, that falls within you know, this idea that we can be self-sustaining, that you can have a working class area that can thrive, right? And so then it started from there. I wanted to make sure that I knew the policy before I was getting up there and just announcing. So I took months reading the Jackson plan from Mississippi to see in what way was it applicable. Talking to there's a couple of researchers that live actually in Ward 5 who I've been working on this potential comic book project with to see all right, what could be moved? Because if I'm better on the outside of this system, if I'm better pushing from the outside, then I'm going to be here and I'm going to be an advocate in that way. I'm going to continue to write stories and tell stories. And what we found was, okay, if we have a if we don't sort of like pre-decide exactly what's going to happen, and we decide, and instead we take the approach of what are the needs, and we start having the conversations, and we start talking to people about what are the needs. Then once we understand what the needs are, for instance, you think about raising the wage. Well, city council might raise the wage, before either one of us is able to be elected, in which case, you know, good. But the state might pass a preemption law that blocks our ability to protect workers in Minneapolis, that blocks our ability to raise the wage. But if the goal is to raise the wage, then we can, and we're steeped in research about how to develop a commercial corridor. Not just that we need to, but how to get home equity into the hands of people who wouldn't otherwise have access to it, right? If we're steeped in research, then we can still meet that goal, right? Maybe we can't accomplish people getting their having the line of credit to buy a home where they get full equity, but if we're willing to invest in like a community land trust model or some of those things, then people could start to at least build partial equity that could transition them into a home where they're building 100% of their equity. Yeah, sorry.
That's great.
Thank you. You know, I want to take this to another level. One of the things that Robert French was sharing when we're on break is, what's our shared commitment and responsibility to deal with young people? I have praised you as young adults for deciding to place your hat in the ring. All of us here have to be responsible for the 5-year-olds, the 10-year-olds, the 13-year-olds, and there is still a problem. And that you set sort of in context with your art, your piece, Brother OSP. I'm concerned that where we used to have just the Crips and the Bloods, in the past 4 or 5 years, there were groups and small groups calling themselves the Taliban. Mm-hmm. And I'm presuming there are groups that call themselves ISIS now in North Minneapolis. I don't know that, but I'm saying if they call themselves Taliban, what else is to come? Mm-hmm. And I'm concerned that there is both an ignorance and an awareness happening in the same space. The ignorance is whatever allows you to make decisions that are destructive to self and others, but awareness is an awareness of how nothing really is off limits, and what's happening in Sudan or what's happening in Palestine or what's happening in Detroit or Chicago can happen here. It's the imagination. And some things that are creeping into the imagination do not bode well.
Right.
How do we as community respond to presenting opportunity option pathways that elevate, celebrate, and direct young men and women to fulfillment, not to self-destruction. Mm. So I want the candidates to talk about that and you to respond to how I've described what I think you're saying.
Well, I take a look at education, because education for all of us can be the divide and conquer
mode.
And
you're an educator.
Absolutely. It's the divide and conquer mode for us. For a kid to get slapped with an IEP when he's only in the third grade, we're looking at, I work for a school district that I won't say, but in the elementary system, you get a kid with an IEP. Now, an individual education plan, because this kid might not have eaten the night before, or maybe saw his parents arguing, or the father left the home. This kid is upset, comes to school, no one's asking questions why it happens. But something triggers the kid, throws a chair across the room, gets mad, yells. This kid needs ADHD, he's ADD. He gotta get him checked out. Goes to the nurse, gets checked out. Mom sharing information, next thing you know, the kid's on medication. Or he's medicated. But now the issue becomes the kid's no longer in the classroom. Every time he acts out because he's looking for attention, he's no longer in the classroom getting the initial instruction. This is in the basis form when we're in elementary education. When that kid continually grows up, he gets into middle school. I got middle school kids who are talking about experimenting with sex, experimenting with bisexual relations, drugs, drinking, before eighth grade. They come into a high school situation like, hey, Mr. French, you can't. What do you mean I gotta follow rules? You gotta follow my rules. Mm-hmm. These are the rules of how we gotta do things. And they'll buck the rules continually. But that bucking a rule, by the time they get in high school, it's too late. Mm-hmm. It's too late. They've learned how to be criminals before they became a criminal. Yeah. And when they get caught now by the police who are sitting out there, we can show up with BLM all we want to. But when they leave, if we have nothing that takes care of these kids afterwards. And it is us. I know my position. I applaud all of you guys for taking the positions that you do to help us out. All I can do is keep my feet stuck to the ground, 2 feet, 10 toes down in the neighborhood, and keep them right and do my best. We can't save them all. But when a kid comes up through the system that way, it's almost systematic as they're raising them up. Because the good ones, it will quote the good ones who are actually paying attention.
Raeisha, what can you do in the public space to protect children, to grow them, and to mitigate the negative choices and expectations that we're discussing now?
Yeah, ooh, you are hitting on it today. Okay, so criminalization of our children is real. I was criminalized, you were, I'm sure you were. We all were in some capacity. And I think your point with education being the beginning is amazing. I have a 8-year-old nephew, and we got a call on Friday that he had been put in the hallway every day of the week, and nobody knew, and we didn't get that call until Friday. Now, this is my nephew, and I'm his aunt, and that's how active we are. It didn't just go to his mom, his dad, and his grandma. It came to auntie, too. And we're all up at the school like, why are we just now finding out that he was being placed? By the second day, you should have called the parents. And so when we talk, so discipline for our children looks very different for their white counterparts in society. Another example, right in North Minneapolis, to answer your question, last Sunday, me and my mom drive into the plaza right there on Broadway where the dollar store and McDonald's and everything is, and we see four police officers surrounded by pretty skinny, small guys who couldn't be any older than 13. So naturally, we drive over. My mother, as an elder, gets out and stands right in the middle of it and says, what's going on? And they say, well, we got called that they were selling drugs. And as we're watching, they're pulling things out of this kid's backpack, and it's literally samples. And there's sample soaps and sample conditioners. And he says to the officer, I was just trying to sell them. You hear me? Here we have an entrepreneur brother. He wasn't selling drugs. He was an entrepreneur. And he was, and God knows he probably wasn't doing it because he was saving it in his piggy bank. He was probably doing it to feed his family that night or himself or keep himself clothed. But he was immediately criminalized because somebody saw him selling something. Now let's take a step back. Absolutely. Are there lots of criminal activities right there in that same plaza? Yes. And all last summer, especially after Justice for Jamal, which I thought was a conspiracy, I constantly complained and constantly called the police because I know for a fact people were selling drugs up there, because when I would walk into the dollar store, the brother would say, I got that hot, I got that holla, you know? And I'd be like, come on, brother, I don't want that. That's not what I'm interested in. But I realized that we criminalize our kids, so it's twofold.
Jeremiah.
Yeah,
a minute.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Well, the criminalization of kids from an early age, I think, does do a lot to sort of diminish their prospects. their ability to how they see themselves. I feel like I experienced that viscerally even. As a teenager, I always tell folks, like, I'm somebody who's, you know, always been pretty mild-mannered guy. I've had two positive interactions with the police, both as adults, with kids I went to high school with who became police. One was at a restaurant, not even in like a uniform situation. So we do have, you know, it does take a toll on how you're able to see yourself. And people tend to meet a certain level of expectation. If you have somebody who's constantly being demonstrated to them that society considers them irrelevant, mm-hmm. whether economically or culturally, you're gonna start to see the benefits, especially of kids who are really impressionable, who don't understand consequences. And so I think for me, it was always the arts. And and it's not gonna be just the arts for everybody, but I think that we need to be able to, put wealth building access into the hands of their families, right? I know we have a very like we think that some people don't deserve in order to have like things like a home ownership and that kind of thing, but then also put hard skills in their hands that they can latch on to and really build those skills.
We're out of time.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, the hour goes so fast. I want to thank all of you for being here. James Burroughs, Chief Inclusion Officer in the Office of the Governor of Minnesota. Thank you for being here. Thank you for what you do. And I'll tell people, use the office, call you up, right? And make sure that your office is responsive to what we want to do and build in community.
Absolutely. You have access to the governor's office through me and through others, but use that access.
Absolutely. Brother OSP, thank you for being a teacher. Thank you for being an artist and for bringing wisdom and spirit feeling to this conversation today. And thank you to Raeisha Williams, and thank you to Jeremiah Ellison, both organizers, activists on the front line in the fight for justice, the fight for liberation.
OSP and sounds like he's on the front line.
He's on the front of the front line. But, you know, committed. Yes. And what I take away from this is that both of you are operating from a sense of both confidence and optimism. You believe that we're going to win, and because you believe that, I guarantee you we will win. Yes. So thank you for doing what you do.
Thank
I'm
you.
Al McFarland. This is Conversations with Al McFarland.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say goodnight. We want to thank Al McFarland for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking, have a robust conversation. Cause this thing is safe, the message is clear. Everybody knows we gotta keep it nice clear. We just going to talk about the Al McFarlane Show.